Okay. Good morning, everyone. My name is Milica Colovic. I am from Montenegro, and currently I'm a PhD student at University of Bari Aldo Moro in Italy, in collaboration with Agronomic Institute of Bari. I'm working on application of remote sensing methods for precision soil and crop management and sustainable use of water and nitrogen resources. And it's my pleasure today that I present my topic to you. When we speak about interest for this project, we are aware of two greatest challenges that we are facing nowadays, which are food security and environmental conservation. So, rapidly rising water and land scarcity is adding further constraints on food production growth. And so, in order to be able to feed growing population, we need suitable technologies and precise tools that will improve crop productivity. We can say that precision agriculture concept is the greatest modification of agriculture because of main concepts, which are maximizing yields and in the same time optimizing resources use, reducing production cost and decreasing environmental impact. Also, proximal and remote sensing technologies are a very great tool, and they are being used currently for precise management of crops and with very nice potential for application in monitoring water and nutrient stress, soil variability, prediction of crop yield, and nutrition, the deficit of nutrition and water stress. Also, in our experiment, we had focused on sweet maize that is considered as widely cultivated and valuable crop in nutrition. When we speak about objectives, first objective was to characterize soil spatial variability in order to have experimental design. And then we focused on investigation of relationship between vegetation indices derived from ground-based sensing, aerial drones, and satellite Sentinel-2 data, and biometric and physiological crop parameters. We try to assess the suitability of red, green, blue images to estimate the crop green biomass of sweet maize. To inquire the applicability of vegetation indices obtained from RGB images in order to distinguish between different water and nitrogen regimes for sweet maize crop. And we test the suitability of vegetation indices obtained from the satellite to estimate the crop coefficient of sweet maize under a different water regime. Here you can see the experimental layout. Experiment was located in the experimental field of Siam Bari that is located, characterized by semi-arid climate and silty loamy soil. Plots, they were in split design. Each treatment was replicated three times. We had a different nitrogen level, low nitrogen and very high nitrogen level, 300 kilograms of nitrogen per hectare, and three different water regimes, full irrigation, deficit irrigation where half of full requirement of crops was applied, and rain-fed crops with plant density of 10 plants per meter square. Plot size was 10 per 10 meter, and in total we had 18 plots. So, as I said, our first objective was to do soil characterization. In order to do that, we used the EMI sensor. We had measurements. This sensor is measuring in vertical and horizontal orientation up to 180 centimeters deep. So after that, we proceeded using surface software to have these maps to see apparent electrical conductivity. And we saw that we have very big variability. So to understand better why is this happening, we had two soil transects where we took soil samples. What we found here was that silty clayey loamy to silty texture with subalkaline pH and moderate to high calcium carbonate. What was characteristics for shallow soil was the lower electromagnetic induction values, less than 20 millisiemens per meter, and for deep soil was high electromagnetic induction values, more than 35 millisiemens per meter, and this was found in a good correlation between deep and more fertile soil. They have higher electromagnetic induction values. So using proximal EMI sensor data and plant growth and yield recording in previous years, we used to identify field homogeneous portions in order to allocate the blocks of the experimental design. For statistical analysis, we had multivariate k-means, and we had three clusters. In one cluster, we saw that it has the highest apparent electrical values, and also from previous years, we saw that is the highest productivity is in that part. So that helped us to understand how to organize our experimental design. When we speak about the other measurements, from the ground, we applied proximal sensing, measuring canopy reflectance and canopy temperature, physiological measurements, leaf gas exchange, leaf chlorophyll content, and biometric parameters. Aerial remote sensing was applied to take red, green, and blue images. And for satellite remote sensing, we took images taken by Sentinel-2. All measurements, they were done on healthy and green leaves, and from the ground measurements, they were done in the noon. So remote sensing techniques, they are based on the reflectance radiation of the plants, have the potential of evaluating water and nitrogen status of plants within the field of view of sensor. Canopy reflectance was measured by handheld spectroradiometer, and data collection was proceeded by use of specific software that is called SpectroView in order to obtain later hyperspectral vegetation indices. Because after proceeding data in the software, they are after that stored in Excel file as a reflectance at the range of continuous bands that they are ready to use in different combinations to calculate vegetation indices. And canopy temperature was measured by a FLIR portable thermal camera to obtain crop water stress index. From the ground, as I said, we measured the net photosynthetic rate, stomata conductance, transpiration rate, biometric measurements to obtain leaf area index dry above ground biomass, and leaf chlorophyll content by using handheld chlorophyll meter, and relative water content that is very good indicator of plant water status. For RGB images, that is a technique that is considered as very nice because of low cost, less labor, and it's a very alternative method that is detecting any change in plants, and it showed very nice performance, especially for detecting the nutrient status of the plants. Measurements, they were taken from the center of each plot by drone with installed camera of 20 megapixels, and it was from 80 to 100 centimeters above plant in zenithal plane. After taking the photos, we proceeded using BreedPix software that is giving, those are just some of the indices because we obtained around 15, but those are the ones that they had the best performance. Indices from this technique are based on color models, hue, saturation, and brightness, CLAB and CLUV. And indices are obtained or like entire average of color from entire photo of separated pixels from the photo. For example, here you can see A index is based on this model. And when we have plants that they are under the stress, they are in this range and they have positive values. Once we have good conditions and healthy conditions for the crop, they will be in this range of green color and they will have more negative value. While, for example, we have index here, green area and greener area, they are based on separated pixels of the plant. However, the rapid advance in remote sensing happened by launching Sentinel-2. The Copernicus Open Access Data Hub is in the official website of European Spatial Agency, offer open and free of charge access of Sentinel-2 images. This Sentinel-2 has high resolution, 10 meter, 20 meter, and 60 meter, with large field of view, 290 kilometers, and 13 spectral bands. Also, what is the advantage of this satellite is that it's taking photos from 5 to 12 days. That is very nice for a crop growing cycle, and it was corresponding to measurements that we done in the ground. So we were able to compare indexes that we have from the ground and also from the satellite. Here is the example of taking NDVI index for each pixel, and in the same time we are also taking pixels for a meteorological station that has a reference grass that is reference for potential evapotranspiration, and it's located exactly next to the field. Yeah, so we try to prove the theory that we can obtain crop coefficient by dividing NDVI of the crop, in our case maize, by NDVI of the grass. After that, we can start speaking about results that we obtained. As you can see, this is a graph for soil water depletion. In the beginning, all three water regimes, they were equal, but after with growing and also with more stress conditions, we can see that full irrigation plants, they didn't face any stress, and all the time they were up to readily available water. While, for example, rain-fed crops, they face very severe stress. Especially here, we can see that it was period of flowering when they are forming the yield, where evapotranspiration was much higher than rainfall. And that was actually the period when they didn't form any yield that is visible here on this graph. For example, rain-fed crops, we didn't have yield from them, while the highest yield was found in full irrigation treatment with nitrogen, and also it was the case for yield water use efficiency. This slide, you can see biometric parameters, leaf area index, and dry above ground biomass with statistical analysis presented. As you can see, the trend of the water regime treatment were well differentiated during the crop cycle. Also, it is clearly shown in statistical analysis that there is a level of significance, the significant difference, while for nitrogen, we didn't found any difference in statistical analysis that was observed by but on the graph, you can see that trend is very visible, that there is difference between nitrogen treatments, but statistical analysis, they didn't show that. Yeah, this is for dry above ground biomass. This is for leaf chlorophyll content. It's different story, and we found a statistical difference between treatments, because that can be explained that because this parameter is very well indicator of nitrogen level, and it can detect any change and also stress if plants are in nutrient and nitrogen deficiency. Also on the graph during the season, it was shown that trends are very well separated. Here are some of ground-based vegetation indices. They were separated, and the highest values, as it was expected, they were found for full irrigation with high nitrogen level, while the lowest values, they were for rain fed without nitrogen, and is for between all water regimes, it was found significant difference. And all the indices, you can see here, SAVI index and also OSAVI, they have very similar trends in different stages. For example, the highest values, they were found in flowering stage. For satellite vegetation indices, here are presented, and also, as I said, the grass that was taken, values of the grass next to experimental field. Here you can see that we found significant difference for all of them, just for irrigation. Why for nitrogen we didn't found. But what is interesting here, that we understood that satellite was able to detect change in water regimes, because before this day, when we have measurement and when we took a photo of the sentinel, we had an irrigation event. So we understood that satellite was able to detect day after that, to detect change that happened in water regime in the plant. It was the same story for all of these indices. For RGB indices, it was something different. As I say, for example, here you can see that the most negative values are for full irrigation with nitrogen, while the lowest are for rain-fed crops. But what is interesting for this technique, that we understood that it can differentiate between nitrogen treatments better than satellite and ground. We found that in statistical analysis. And because also in many other work in literature, it was reported that this technique is able to detect any change in fertilization rate, and those parameters are so sensitive on that. So also we proved in our experiment that this technique was able to catch differences in terms of nitrogen, and it's showing in all these indices. While, for example, ground-based and satellite techniques, they were not able to detect nitrogen differences. Here, as I said about crop coefficient, here is showing graph for crop coefficient. We calculated crop coefficient as a ratio between NDVI from the crop and NDVI from the grass. It was expected that highest values will be for full irrigation with nitrogen, and value was 1.1, that is corresponding to a value that is found in the literature. For example, in FAO 56, value for maize in flowering stage is 1.1. So also in this technique, using satellite, we found the same, and it can be used also for this purpose. It was proved also by also with other articles in other work I found it. And here you can see in first growth stage, it was the same, but here are 3 pixels of meteorological station. But by the time it was, it's visible that it's differentiated between treatments. When we speak about correlation between, as I said, our goal was to correlate indices, vegetation indices, and different biometric and physiological parameters. And for example, the best correlation was found between leaf area index and AVI derived from satellite, and biomass and AVI derived from ground-based. But still, it's not very high value of R parameter. But for example, RGB technique had a bigger value of R coefficient, especially for green area index and leaf area index, and between A index and biomass, it was found the greatest correlation. So what we can conclude from our work, that biometric and physiological parameters were significantly affected by irrigation regimes, but not by nitrogen level. Most of RGB indices demonstrated the suitability to predict the crop biometric parameters under irrigation and nitrogen treatments. Also, RGB indices were more suitable to distinguish plant nutrient levels than spectral indices, which are more reliable to assess different water regimes. Also, vegetation indices from ground-based and Sentinel-2 were able to estimate and predict biomass growth, especially in full development stage. And a ratio between NDVI of maize and NDVI of grass, assessed by Sentinel-2, show the same behavior of KC that was explained before in the literature. So we can say that remote sensing images obtained from low-cost and labor-saving technologies, drones and satellites, represent affordable tool for precision agriculture in practice, and they are used more and more in work in many countries. And thank you for your attention.